the letters. Just kidding. Y'all already saw it. It's This Is Love. But y'all, we're going to be doing some letters soon. Just know it. This is love. This is love. So tonight, I want you to write down this statement, and then we're going to pray before we get into our time in the Word. And it's going to be epic. You guys ready to grow tonight? Now, listen, I want to pray over you tonight. What is this? This is a chewed up lid that my dog chewed. And why is it in my Bible? I just saw that. Will you take that for me? Yes. Pep, she's awesome. Okay. Some of you guys are going back to school next week. And so help me remember to pray over them at the end. Yeah. Okay. What was I going to say before that? Write this down. If he is not love, you will never experience it. Now, our leaders are going to pass around a heart to you right now. Just grab it and hold on to it. You'll need it for the message. Write that down, though. If he is not love, you will never experience it. So that's kind of what we want to unpack tonight. If he is not love, you will never experience it. The title of the message is Love Through the Years. Love Through the Years. If he is not love, you will never experience it. And the title tonight is Love Through the Years. Father God, as we look at your word tonight, we know that it is health and medicine and life to all of our flesh. God, it is your anointing that destroys the yoke of bondage off of people's lives. Paul even said, I did not come to you with eloquency of speech, but with fear and trembling. Why? Because God, in me, I have nothing. I can do nothing. I am nothing without you. So I invite you to think through my thoughts and speak through my mouth. God, you know what's going on in every young person's heart tonight. And I believe for a supply of the Spirit, God, that there would be answers, that they would leave here tonight encouraged. They would leave here tonight more free than when they came in. God, I know that your word is profitable for training in righteousness. So for all of those believers that are in here tonight, I believe that they're being trained to reflect righteousness. For those who don't know you yet, God, I believe that their hearts are being opened to a relationship with you. God, our eyes are on you. Our eyes aren't on me. Our eyes are on you, Father. You are the teacher of the church by your Spirit. So do the work that you need done in the hearts of every hungry young man and young woman in this room. In Jesus' name, amen. So if he is not love, you will never experience it. Now, before we even get started into this, I want you to actually, you're going to go in your Bible to two places. And then I'm just going to give you references that you can just jot down in your notes for the rest of the night. So go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 19. Because you guys have to decide, just because it's all in the book doesn't mean believers believe everything that's in the book. So you've got to believe what the word says about salvation. You've got to believe what the word says about finances. You've got to believe what the word says about your healing. You've got to believe what the word says about your peace. Everything that's in the book, you've got to take advantage of. Have you guys ever been to a restaurant and literally you've only ever gotten the same thing every time? You've never tried everything else on the menu, right? We've probably all done that because that's our favorite. But we could actually be missing out on some other really great stuff. Now, maybe not, depending on the restaurant, but in the Word of God, we miss out if we don't realize that this is truth in every realm of life. Now, especially as it pertains to love, and we typically talk about love every February because of Valentine's Day, but with the whole, like, love is love and all of this, there's such a perversion of what love is and who love is, but you're still going to have to decide. I'm going to show it to you in scripture tonight, but you're going to still have to decide. In 1 Corinthians 3:19, for what the world says is wisdom is actually foolishness. Now, if you watch, and I totally bypassed all those announcements. We'll have to do that at the end as well. All those ads I was supposed to show. If you watch The Simple Truth with Pastor Dean every day, and you may not be able to watch it live, but you can watch it at the end of the day, that word foolishness, you can write it in your Bible or write it in your notes. In the Greek, that actually means moronic, like a moron. The wisdom of this world is actually moronic. The Greek word is actually our word for moron. Okay, that's how God sees people's opinions, people's ideas that contradict the word of God. For what the world says is wisdom is actually foolishness in God's eyes. As it is written, the cleverness of the know-it-alls becomes the trap that ensnares them. And so write this down. You decide in every realm of life to make the word of God your standard for truth. You have to decide that. And you have to decide on purpose. And if your doctrine isn't complete, it's kind of like your wardrobe. Today, y'all, I decided to go ahead and get completely dressed. And everyone's like, you're welcome. Thank you, right? I didn't just put on my bottoms and be like, okay, I'm good. Which that's what the body of Christ looks like that only accepts salvation. They're vulnerable. They're exposed to the curse, which exists if you don't suit up in the full armor of God, which is the truth of God's word. And you have to decide to do that. And I'm here to cheer you on. I'm here to teach you how to do it. I'm here to walk with you as you do it, because you have your whole life in front of you. You have such an advantage because you're not hearing this after 3 or 4 decades of making the wrong decisions. You might be sitting there like, well, I've got like a couple years, a couple semesters of bad decisions. We can work with that. We can work with that, okay? But if you don't do your part, just writing the notes, just hearing the scriptures is not enough. You have to decide. See, when I was your age and a little bit younger, I took the word of God and I said, God, you are going to be the definition of love to me. Look at this verse, 1 John 4:10. Go there. And then I won't have you turn anymore. We'll just make note of these and you can look them up later. 1 John 4:10, this is our foundation verse for this month. I'm reading from the Passion Bible, so yours might read a little bit different. 1 John chapter 4, verse 10. I love all of John. The Gospel of John, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. Nothing in the, they just hit. Especially if you're not feeling love, if you're not feeling confident in your salvation, read John. And then 1 John 2, read in, just find John, any of the Johns. 1 John 4:10, this is love. Everyone say, this is love. What does that mean? This is love, colon, means I'm about to tell you what love is. So you have to decide, that's true to me. That's true to me because that's what the word says. And I'm not going to let Romans 10, 9, and 10 be true to me and not let this be true to me and find some other definition of love. John said, no, this is love. He loved us long before we loved him. It was his love, not ours. He proved it by sending his son to be the pleasing sacrificial offering to take away our sins. So what is love? He is love. And the fact that he loved us first, and we're simply responding. Now, guys, we're not going to unpack it tonight. We'll get into it next week. But that is huge. Because if you're the most important person in your relationship with God, your eyes are in the wrong way. You're looking at things the wrong way. He's got to be the most important person. If you're the most important person in your relationship with God, you'll be religious. You'll have this attitude that says, oh, I have to do my quiet time. Oh, I have to come to church. Oh, my mom's going to make me come that family night. So stupid. I would rather play video games all night until I can't even see out of my eyeballs anymore. Or whatever. I don't know if that's ever actually happened. I don't think I'm like, I play a good teenage boy. Was that what I just was? I'm not sure. I was never in drama, guys. I was only in choir. But whatever it is, you know, like that means your relationship with God is all about you. But when your relationship with God is all about him, meaning you wake up in the morning, like eyes wide open, like God loves me today. And God has good things for me today. And God cares about every little bitty detail of my life. The things that I say and the things that I think. You know, over Christmas holiday, I'd received some gift cards for my birthday and I hadn't spent them. And so my birthday's in November. So December rolls around. I'm like, sweet, I still got those gift cards. So I went and bought some stuff. And then above the gift cards, of course, because there was just, it went over the. And so as I was checking out, I was like, oh, I would really like to have a pair of these, you know? But I was like, you don't need those. Like, you already have those. You know, I didn't even say it out loud. I just thought it. Y'all, less than a week later, somebody gave me those very things. Who is that from? God who loves me and who I am absolutely his favorite, right? Because I didn't need those. That was just a low-key desire. It wasn't even like, I had never even thought about it. It wasn't like I'd had that desire for like weeks or months or even years. I just got the desire when I saw it. And then I was like, no, I'm not going to do it. I could have done it, right? But I didn't. And God totally hooked me up. That happens all the time. When you make your relationship with God where he's the most important and not you, you wake up, eyes wide open, God, you're going to help me today. Whatever challenge I face, your yoke is easy and your burden is light. Otherwise, you're the most important. You're like, oh my God, I got to be a good Christian today. I got to be obedient. I got to do my homework. Do you know what I'm saying? So I got to be nice to so-and-so because I told her yesterday I forgave her, even though I really didn't. This is love, y'all, that he loved us first. And 1 John 4:8 says that God is love. So love is not a feeling. Love is a person. Now, it has expressions, which is why, because God's goodness covers the earth, people who are unbelievers can have glimpses of his love. Unbelievers that are maybe married might find moments of joy and satisfaction in relationships when they yield to the fruits of love, which are in 1 Corinthians 13:4-8. But ultimately, let's go back to our statement. If he is not love, you'll never experience it. Now, when we're kids, let's go back in time and think about, and you can just write it in your notes this way, love equals security when you're a kid, right? You love the things that make you secure when you're a kid. Now, depending upon how you were raised, you had a full supply of security or you felt left out. Because in many cases, our parents can provide our first picture of what love looks like because they make us feel secure. They take care of us. Now, automatically, if you didn't have both parents or you didn't have either one of your parents, you grow up with a real confused idea about what love even is. Because in a childlike state, love means security. I love the things that make me feel safe. Okay, like if you were like Miguel and you had like a blankie that you took everywhere when you were little. I just thought it'd be funny if I said that he did that. I don't know if he really did that. I didn't have a blankie, but maybe you had a stuffed animal, right? Maybe you had an actual dog. When you're little, what do you... That's the cutest pug ever. So when you're little, you equate love to things that make you feel secure and things that make you feel safe. Like even some of your teachers, like when you serve in children's church, some of you that serve in children's church, they run up to you, they hug you, they love you. If you're in middle school, they don't love you yet. You have to be like a little bit older, but they run up to you and they love you. Why? Because you make them feel safe. You make them feel secure. But here's the thing. If you haven't had that, then automatically, like I said, you face this internal deficit. And listen, God has a plan for that. Don't you think he knew? Jeremiah 1:5 says that he knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. Because we all have a free will, the fact is some parents don't do their very best in that endeavor. But God has a fail-safe for you. So it's like you have to look past your parents or the things that make you feel secure and say, James 1:17 says every good and every perfect gift comes from him. So you're sitting next to somebody that's got a really pretty secure upbringing. They've got dogs, they've got their blankie, and they've got both of their parents in their childhood. You don't have that. Guess what? Both of you have to look past your circumstances and say, he's love. He's really love. Psalm 68:5 says that he's a father to the fatherless. Now, to the degree that you don't do this, guys, insecurity always turns into pride and rebellion. There's no other place for it to go. Tonight, when we look at this love through the years, I want you to identify if the enemy has been successful in your childhood years in jacking your security and what should have been your potential definition of love. I want you to rip him off by taking back what love or who love really is. Because here's the thing, You know, I remember when Pastor Greg made a decision to follow what he knew in his heart to be God's next step for him when he moved to Hobbs. So I was graduating from Rhema Bible Training Center on a Friday night. I had just completed my third year. He was a year ahead of me. So he had gone home a year prior while I was finishing out my last year of school, because he was going to work with his one of his family's companies or whatever. So he went home. So I knew I was going home. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not following any boy anywhere. Like, if there's no ring, no. No, not happening. So I'm going home. So Tuesday, I'm graduating Friday. And let me just slip this in there. I had nothing packed. Like, I had a whole apartment. Literally, when my sister got there on Friday, she was so mad. She was like, nothing's packed. I'm like, what's your problem? Here's a box. Start packing. Like, it's fine. I was busy. Okay, I had things going on. I was saying goodbye to all my four friends. Okay, so over and over and over. Okay, so Tuesday night, I'm on the phone with Greg, and he's like, hey, I'm going to move to Hobbs. And I was like, what? What? Excuse me? He was like, yeah, I'm gonna drive down Friday for your graduation, and then I'll drive home. You know, I'll follow your family on Saturday. And I'm like, could we have planned this? Where are you going to live? Where are you going to live? You can't just move to Hobbs. Back then, y'all, there's no apartments. We looked for a solid month and we found nothing on the market except places that people use to deal drugs, to make drugs, to use drugs. Like scary, scary places. All the apartments that are in our world right now in Hobbs, New Mexico, they were not there. And so I'm like, Okay, great. Sounds great. Perfect. Awesome. Okay, see you then. Bye. You know, like, wow, that's not a lot of heads up. But I was thinking about it today because when Greg did that, his parents didn't pay for that. You know what I'm saying? You don't go into your mom as a man. Do you know what I'm saying? As a young man. And girls, put your eyes on young men, especially that are about to graduate. Because if their moms are paying all their bills, okay, if they don't have a job, you can't ride on your parents' security. They can bless you, but you better be being diligent. So he didn't go into his parents' room and say, hey, I'm going to move to Hobbs. You guys, can y'all give me some money and blah, blah, blah. No. He went with what he had in his account, his savings account. He took everything that could fit in his Honda Accord, which he sold that car. She's still driving it, y'all. She likes it. I see that car all the time in this town, the girl that bought it from him. Anyway. Anything that could fit in his car, that's it. He didn't have a bed. He didn't have nothing but what could fit in his trunk. But he knew he had heard God, and so God was going to have to take care of him. Do you understand what I'm saying? I use that illustration because Greg had great parents. Okay? But your parents can't be your security. They can't be the foundation for your faith and for your love. Because the reality is all of us could probably raise our hands and say, you know what, there's been some imperfections in my upbringing, right? Well, that's not the solitary place of love. You look past those vehicles because if you don't, you make excuses. And when you don't deal with that in your elementary years, what happens when you're a teenager? From a teenager's perspective, in many cases, love is tied to my identity. So if I don't have a boyfriend or a girlfriend, and I feel excluded from the majority, from what everybody else is doing, then I feel lost. If I don't have what it seems like everybody else has in my appearance, in what I wear, in how I look, I equate acceptance. I equate relationships to love. But guys, love is not based in what you have, what you look like, and who you're dating. God is love. And this is love that He sent His only Son to die for you. So the foundation that should be established is as a child that says, I'm going to take advantage of these great things that God's provided for me, should further be enforced when you become a teenager, where you say, you know what? I don't care what anybody thinks about me. I don't need a man. I don't need a little girlfriend to make me feel good about myself. I don't need a certain brand. I don't need to look a certain way. I don't need to be the center of attention. Because the thing about it is, let's say that this, I'm going to find me a boyfriend for my heart really fast. Hey, this guy kind of looks like Justin Bieber. Y'all aren't going to be able to see it, but I see it. Okay. Without him being the foundation of love in my life, these things have nothing to stick to, which is why they don't stick. Do you understand what I'm saying? You have to accept this is love. He is love, not this red heart. He is love. And if he isn't, I will never experience it. And so because he is love and he's my security, I'm not gonna be emo and depressed because my dad walked out of my life or I don't even know my dad. It's not my favorite. And I definitely have a different set of circumstances than the person sitting next to me. But the reality is at the end of the day, you're gonna stand each and every one of you without your dad or your mom at the judgment seat of Christ. And for many of you that haven't had those relationships, you've had the advantage of not having somebody that you could depend on, and you had to lean in and press into your relationship with God even at a younger age. What am I trying to say? Don't make yourself a victim. Don't make yourself a victim if he's already made you victorious. Okay? So if you don't realize that he's your security and then he's your identity, see, when everybody is blending in and doing the same thing, the people of God are called to stand out. And when he's your identity, you don't care if you're not. Guys, do you think in even 3 years from now, anybody's going to remember what you were wearing? If you were best dressed or if you had the coolest, nobody cares about that. Do you think even 1 year from now, anybody's going to care what kind of car you're driving or if you're even driving one? Those things are so temporary. They're so fleeting. They don't carry the most weight. But unfortunately, we spend a lot of time obsessing about them. We spend a lot of time thinking about them. We instead of going to the Father and going to his word, if we're a little girl, we think that a little boy's going to fix our problems. Or instead of going to the word and pursuing his plan for our life and being a young man of integrity, we think, and listen, I get it, especially if you've got family there's such a pressure, it seems as though, like, if you don't have somebody by the time you're 17, it's like your parents and your whole family feels like you're not right or you're never going to find anybody. You're like 17. Do you know what I'm saying? You have plenty of time to find somebody. Right? There's other places to find or to pursue God's right plan for your life rather than the halls of your school. Do you know what I'm saying? And I'm not being ugly, but when you realize, okay, God, I'm going to be identified with you. Colossians 2:20 says that you're complete in him. I'm not complete in my friends. I'm not complete in a relationship. I'm not complete in what I have. If you're not confident that you really are complete in him, then deprive yourself of those things that you seem to be so confident in and see how bad it bugs you. You know what I mean? Wear the same thing for 3 weeks. Break up with all those hoes. Do you know what I mean? You know what I mean? I love you, but I'm just saying it's not going to stick. It's not going to stick. Because if he isn't love, you'll never experience it. He has to be your security. He has to be your identity. And see, these issues don't go away. When you move into your adult years, many adults equate love with possessions, which ultimately influences their priorities. Now, this is such a big deal because without really understanding, guys, when you really understand love, you live your life for his cause. Nothing's more important because at the end of your life, that's all that's going to matter is what you've done for the kingdom. What keeps most adults, and because judgment begins in the house of the Lord, we're focusing on believers. What keeps a lot of believers distracted? 1 Timothy 6:10, just write it down. I'll read it to you. Loving money is the first step towards all kinds of trouble. Some people run after it so much that they've given up their faith. Craving more money pushes them away from the faith into error, compounding misery in their lives. So as you mature, and if you don't get this right in your young years, then as an adult, really, how can you tell what an adult loves? Their priorities. You can tell what an adult loves by their priorities. If they love money, then they may prioritize work. If they love pleasure, they may prioritize recreation. My mom's dad, my grandpa, he hunted, he fished, he was all about his recreation. He spent most of their money, my mom said, when she was growing up. She had to bring in her shoes to make sure that like they were old enough to be replaced. But he was always buying guns. He had so many guns. He made his own ammo. I'm pretty sure I have tons of his gunpowder in my garage right now. Don't tell anybody. But like for like enough to like fill a army band of soldiers. I don't know what it's called. He was passionate about his recreation. You could tell what my grandpa loved just by getting in his truck. You could tell what my grandpa loved by going in his shop, by going in his garage. You can tell what some adult women love by where they spend their money, by what's important to them, by their priorities. What am I saying? When he is your priority, because he's supposed to have a certain spot in our life. And if you will get this right now, it'll be that much easier when you're an adult. And you won't, like Matthew 6:33 says, to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added to you. You'll let God add these things to you. Because see, when he's your security, and you know that, God, you are love. This is love. God, you are my security. You know, to be honest, my parents loved me, but like, you know, when I left. They cried the whole way home when they dropped me off at college. Now that's on them for being little crybabies. But I'm just saying, like, if I was a little tenderoni, I would have been like, I don't want that blonde person as my husband anymore. But he's the only boy on here. This guy's kind of weird looking, but it's fine. Y'all aren't going to see this, but I'm really entertained. I'm going to have fun at church tonight. Thank you guys for allowing me. Y'all, they cried the whole way home. You know what I mean? And if I would have been a little tenderoni, my sister was distraught. She was writing me letters. She was doing crafts. She made me a scrapbook. Faith doesn't sit still for any of that. I couldn't get her to do a scrapbook to save my life when I was like trying to make her do homeschool when she was in fifth grade. She's making me scrapbooks and stuff. Y'all, I would have, and this is what I'm saying. If those places are your security, how are you gonna tune them out to hear his voice? Because I went thousands of miles away and I was 17 years old. But I knew that he was gonna take care of me and he was gonna protect me because ultimately he was my security. My identity was in him. Y'all, when I left everybody. My friends from home, my church friends, they would call. I didn't answer. I did not answer their calls, hardly ever. Then they started writing letters. Then they started sending cards. Y'all, you would have thought I was like a foreign exchange student in another country, as much mail as I was getting, seriously. But why? Because I'm like, I'm moving on. They would call me, hey, we're at Pizza Hut Sunday after church. Care. I'm not at Pizza Hut with you guys. Don't call me. I don't care what you're eating. Like, I'm taking an afternoon nap. My church already ended. I'm an hour ahead. You know what I mean? Because they weren't my identity. They weren't my identity. I knew what love was. I knew who love was. And so when you maintain that posture, then there's no fear. There's no toil about accumulating a house because he's your number one. This is a little house sticker. He adds that to you. Pastor Greg's already on here. He's right here. Now, I don't want a motorcycle, so I'm not going to put that on here. But let me find some other stuff. Pizza. Yes. I'm going to add that pizza on here. What happens when you mess around with things and you use them incorrectly? It causes injury. And really, when your heart gets broken, it's one of the hardest places in your soul to fix. Which is why we want you to know the truth about how it's supposed to look. Mark 12:30, and I'm going to read it in the Passion in the Message. It says, "Listen, Israel, the Lord your God is one. Love God with all your passion, all your prayer, all your intelligence, and all your energy." The Amplified says, "Love him with all your soul, your life, your heart, with all your mind, your thoughts, your understanding, with all your strength. And then selfishly love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." So if he isn't love, you'll never experience it. If you have a pen, I want you to write those three words on your heart. And if you don't, you'll just have to memorize them. But what is he? He's security, he's identity, and he's priorities. He's my security. If he's not your security, you'll always be insecure. If you don't identify with him, you'll always lack confidence. And if he's not your number one priority, guys, you can gain the whole world and lose your soul. It'll never be enough. You'll never have a nice enough car. You'll never have a good enough spouse. You know, good-looking people cheat on their spouses all the time. Not that it's okay to cheat on your spouse if they're not good-looking, because of course, it's horrible, it's ratchet. But what I'm saying is, from the outside, like, what's your problem? Well, the problem is, he isn't love. Because if he's love, then you know how to do business in the earth. You know how to treat people. You know where to expend your passions. Guys, you only have so much time. You only have so much energy. There's things that I like. There's things that I enjoy, but I make zero time for. You know why? Because other things have to carry more weight in my life. They have to be more important to me because they're eternal. They're eternal. There's not a lot of shows on television that I would like to watch, but the couple that are there, I watch while I get my nails done, which is 1 hour once every 2 weeks, right? That's the only time I watch HGTV, which one of my leaders calls it Holy Ghost TV because she likes it too. It's not. It's Home and Garden TV. But there's a lot of things that I might enjoy that aren't even bad things. But y'all, as an adult, because I made a decision early on, and you have the same decision that you can make right now. If you've been making excuses for the absence of a dad, for the absence of a mom, for the absence of everybody that was supposed to love you and raise you up in the nurture and the admonition of God, I want to encourage you tonight to look past their mistakes and see the heart of God. See the face of God that knew you, that knows you, and that will provide for you in spite of their mistakes. If your whole world and your whole identity has been centered around who likes you, who dates you, who you've slept with, who you've made out with, whatever, there's a reason why your soul's mashed up. Because if he isn't love, you'll never experience it. And then you grow up into an adult version of yourself with all the wrong priorities, looking for love in all the wrong places. I want you to watch this video. It's one of my favorites that we've ever made in this church. And then I'm going to pray over you. Be real still. Be real quiet. This is literally at this point between you and Jesus because you have a decision to make. Am I going to let him be who he's supposed to be? Is he going to be security? Is he going to be identity? Because y'all, it so impacts me that at the end of my life, you know, honestly, me and Pastor Greg do almost everything together. You know, we're best friends. But at the end of my life, he's not going to be there. He's a great husband. You know, at the end of my life, no matter how much we joke, and I don't want to like hit you hard like you first realized there was no Santa, I don't know that all dogs go to heaven. I hope they do. I mean, I hope Pep's there, but the reality is Pep may not be there. My mom's not going to be there. I love my mom. I love my dad. I love my sister. I love the people that I do life with. I love you guys. But y'all, at the end of my life, I'm going to be there by myself. And I don't want to look at the holes in his hands, in the hole in his side, and to not have prioritized who he was on this side of eternity. I want him to be my everything because he wants to be that for me. I don't want to put my trust in things. I don't want to put my trust in myself or in my talent or in my ability to figure it out. I don't want to put my trust in my looks, especially if you're a redhead. Like, they can call it ginger or whatever. No, it's not ginger. It's like genetically malfunctioned. Believe me, like every nickname in the world that I ever heard, horrible, right? Definitely not going to put my security, my identity in those things. Where you live, what you drive, what you have. When I'm going to stand before him at the end of my life and he is love. Those things aren't love. How I feel about my, you know, people, it's love. It's not love. He's not love in your life. Your little relationship, it's crap. It's crap. It's not love. I want to tell you the truth tonight. He is love. Watch this video, then we're going to pray.